he just showcased to you. So like you saw, EventEA website is the one where you bought all your tickets and applied for the call for papers and all the stuff. So that's basically hosted on this server. It's using that server. Our server is mainly now deployed into Kubernetes, but like he showed you later on that the admin features that's are there. So you can always host your event in EventEA, that's always there. But if you want to make your own event organizer server, use this open source project to create a server where you want other people to host your events, then you need to deploy it to your like local systems, right? So ours is deployed into Kubernetes because we felt that it would be easier to scale it in Kubernetes and stuff. But there are a lot many other places where you can host. So I will go through a very like main step that we always do to host the event organizer server. That's just the local deployment steps. But firstly, I will give you a brief overview. So as he has said, it's an event management server. It has almost all the features. The idea was that we would have a closure of all the event management websites that we already have, right? So there is Eventbrite, there is Eventnook, there is some other scheduling websites and stuff, but what we needed is we go to one place, we get everything. We don't need other places to visit for other tasks, right? So that was the idea, and moreover, the idea is it's completely open source, right? So you can host your own, means make your own event management server. So you have a college or an institution where you host other kind of events, or there are a group of people who host events. So you can always create your own server deployments. So yeah, as I can say, these are all the ways of deploying to, means we have already ready these ways of deploying. So you can install everything manually, like completely manually. You get a Linux system or a Windows system or even a Mac, and you follow all these steps. Some of these steps vary from system to system, but mostly it's the same. Then there's Vagrant, like if you don't want to go through it manually, you just want to give it a go and like you do Vagrant up and stuff. So you can always use Vagrant. There's Docker because yeah, containerization is the next thing. Everyone is hearing that. Then AWS. AWS is a legacy thing, you might say, because everyone uses. Though there was a problem in AWS S3 and all those stuff, but okay. We still have that. Google Compute Engine, Kubernetes. Kubernetes is also one of Google Cloud thing only. And then there's Heroku. So Heroku is like, if you want to have a free or like you don't want to pay and you want to just check whether your deployment works, so Heroku is one of good options. So these are the ways to deploy. The stack used, yeah. So a quick raise of hands, like how many of you have worked in a or deployed a project which works in Flask and PostgreSQL? Okay, you are there because you worked on this one. So anyone who has worked in Flask and PostgreSQL, it's pretty much all the same steps that we follow in a Flask and PostgreSQL project. So like all the requirements.txt to be installed using pip and all those stuff. And apart from that, like to reduce the file size and the project size, we have used Bower. Bower is for installing the JS packages. We didn't use any as such JS frameworks. Like because we didn't want, like if Angular breaks tomorrow, we don't want our system to break as well. So we mostly rely on JavaScript, native JavaScripts and jQuery. But yeah, obviously there are some JavaScript libraries that we need for drag and drop and stuff like that. But mostly those libraries are also based on jQuery. Yeah, right. So that's basically the end of slides. Now I will go through the steps to deploy it. So this is basically our project link. If you can see github.com/FOSSASIA/OpenEventOrgServer. So if you go into the README, there's a big list of installations, okay? So all you have all the like steps for all kind of installations. You don't need to worry about them. It's kind of like quite vividly mentioned in every step how to install everything. So I will go through the general installation or the local installation thing, because that's what, if you want to contribute to the project, you will be needing the local installation stuff. But you can, yeah, to like right away start off with the development, you can always do Vagrant. And if you want to deploy, then there are all this set of from 4 to 9, I would say, if you want to deploy your own server and host your own events, then you can go through 4 to 5. But I will go through step 2 mainly, and then I think Niranjan will talk about Kubernetes a little more. So yeah, so what do you do to deploy your own organizer server? Firstly, you will need Python to PostgreSQL, right? So making Python to work on your system is your like own concern. Making PostgreSQL work on your own system is your own concern. If PostgreSQL breaks in your system, that's not our fault. That's nothing to do with the project. So let's just clarify that part. Yeah. So you can always do PostgreSQL installation using sudo apt-get install PostgreSQL, PostgreSQL contrib. If you are using a Fedora flavor of Linux, then you can do DNF install instead of apt-get install, and it would work similarly. Now we need NVM, Node.js and all those stuffs for installing Bower mainly. If you can install Bower and build it from its own GitHub repository, it's perfectly fine. We don't need it. So, but you know, it's better to do it using NPM, right? So after you have Node.js, NPM and all those stuffs which most people already have, then we go to the main steps of installations. So yeah, the infamous step or the famous step, sudo pip install minus r requirements.txt. So that's a step I guess all the Python projects have. So you might say that this step doesn't, like, everyone knows this step. You see a Python project, the first thing you do is sudo pip install minus r requirements.txt. So yeah, you do that, all your Python dependencies get installed, like Flask, Flask Rest Plus, and there are other Flask Python libraries that we have been using. Right, so that gets installed. There are few problems you might face, like if it's your first project and you're starting from scratch, then you might need to install your Python dev package from apt-get, or if it's your Fedora flavor, then it would be Python hyphen devil, and it would be sudo dnf install python hyphen devil. So whatever flavor you have, it might change a little bit. But mainly this is kind of the Ubuntu or the Debian flavor that we have followed. Yeah, so we can go through it. And you can say that I can assure you it works on Fedora because I am using Fedora right now. So yeah. And then if you have done all these steps, so your Python dependencies should be installed by now. So you have all the Python dependencies installed. Now you need a database, because without the database, where are you going to store the information? So what you do is you go into PostgreSQL, PSQL and all those stuff. You create a new user, whatever you want to name the user, give a password. Don't give the password start, obviously, because, yeah, obvious reasons. Then create database and all those stuff. Now what we have done is, yeah, we use PostgreSQL, but you can use SQL Alchemy or other databases as well, because we are finally using ORMs, right? So we can, that's why you want to give a preference to MySQL, you can do MySQL as well. So that's your preference. We have specifically done it using PostgreSQL, and we know it works good with PostgreSQL. So yeah, then you do the JavaScript installation. So JavaScript installations is, if you have Bower, then you don't need to do the first step, and then you just do Bower install, and it will all like install and download all your JavaScript dependencies. So after all this is done, all your installations are basically done here. So you have the entire project, entire thing that's needed in your for deploying this project. So your project is ready to be deployed. Now, we wanted, the first idea of Mario and our team was that we wanted to make the project as much customizable as possible. Like you saw that form, we have like switch on and off buttons so that we can customize according to what the event needs for a call for paper thing, right? So the same thing we wanted to do for database URLs or the server names and all those stuffs as well. So database URL, we are not hard coding it into the code. We have an environment variable set as database URL. So you set the environment variable database URL to whatever database URL you are using. This will basically, PostgreSQL :// oevent will basically set it up to, it will set it up the username and the passwords. If it's the username and the password of the database is same as the username and the password for your system or wherever you are hosting, then it will set it up like that. Otherwise, you can also set it up, just give me a second, I hope it works here. Yeah, so otherwise you can also do something like this. So this, the first part, open event user is the username, start is the password, @ it's the localhost, so it's the IP address, and then the port. So whichever way you want to do, you can do that. Even if you have a MySQL setup, you can do MySQL. If it's SQLite, you can use SQLite. So that's completely upon you. So you, at that case, you will just need to change the database URL. And every time you create a new database, so suppose you have like you want to create another event or another event management host system, so you don't need to go through the entire system settings again. You just create a new database and you change the database URL, so then again it will store all the information in the new database. So you don't have to do the installation again from the beginning. And the server name, yeah, server name works the similar way. It's also an environment variable that we are setting so that we can have like the IP address and the port. So for the security purposes, mainly we use the server name so that we can check the URL from which the things are being sent and stuff. Okay, so after all this thing is done for PostgreSQL, you have to restart the system so that like all the database and stuffs have been made and all the changes have been made. So yeah, pseudo service PostgreSQL, this works in most of the Linux systems, and if you are using Mac, you can use Brew. After you have done this, then you need to create the tables. So for creating the tables, there is a file called create_db.py in the project. Excuse me. So Python create_db.py, if you do that, that will create basically all the tables that are needed for setting up the event, like the event management server. So once all the tables are set up, now you have all the columns and tables ready, you can go and work with it. And yeah, Python manage.pb, pydb stamp it. So what this does is, so we are using a management system so that we don't, like, if suppose tomorrow we make a change in the database and you just need to pull your code again and you just need to migrate it. You don't need to create the database again. So that's why we are using the migration tool that's available in Flask. It's also available in Django. So I guess some of you might have worked with it. So what it does is, after you have done db stamp head, so it will like stamp, it kind of provides a stamp, or you can say it kind of point to the last revision that we have made into the migration. So the next time we change something and we create another migration, so we just need to do python manage.pydb upgrade. So that will upgrade it to the next version. So that way you can update your database, you may say the table things and all the stuff. So that basically, after you have done step 6, your server is actually ready to go. So basically, even if you don't do step 7 and you directly go to python manage.py run server of this step and you run it, and your server is running. You can use all the features and all those stuffs, and almost, I won't say the entire server would be running, but almost everything would be running. Now, some of the features that are there, we wanted it to be like real time, right? So if there's a notification, we don't really want the notification, like if you have created an event, so the event management or the admin should get a notification as well as an email. So we don't want that email or the notification to arrive like after some time. We want it to be real time as much as possible. So for those things, we have used Redis and Celery. Celery is mainly used for like scheduling some of the tasks. So suppose we have some of the tasks like the deleted events he was showing, but the deleted events also, we can't keep all the deleted events forever, right? Because then our database would like go a huge size, so we can't do that. So what we do is we keep a time after which the deleted events get deleted. So this kind of scheduling works. For this kind of scheduling works, we are using Flask Celery. Also, there are other scheduling tasks. For example, suppose you are buying a ticket. So you will see when you buy a ticket, there's a like 10 minute session. So after you create the 10 minute session, it's in pending state. After that, it gets into a rejected state. But even the rejected states are stored in the database, right? But we again don't want all the rejected state tickets to be there in the database. So we want it to be deleted just after, like after we have already gone through some time, like maybe 72 hours or something like that, and then we will have like, we can delete all the rejected tickets that we already have. So for those kind of tasks and all other scheduling tasks, we made Celery. So after you have installed Redis server in whatever way that is, you can use apt-get. It should be okay. So I think it should be apt-get. So there is already an issue in the documentation. So any one of you who wants to create a pull request, yeah, sure, go ahead. I will merge it right now. And then there is sudo dnf install redis server. So that's for the Fedora and the Red Hat flavors. And after that, you have done integrate_socket. This is again an environment variable, so you set it to environment variable. If you want to use socket IO, you will be having to set it to true. If you don't want to use it, it's false, perfectly fine. most of the DL10 things might not work, but yeah, otherwise it's perfectly fine. After that, if you have done this, all the steps are done, you go to localhost colon 5000 and your project is running. So that's basically everything you need to do, but you might say, okay, so is this easy and it will go this smooth? Obviously not. As we know, while installing every project, we will face some problems, and that has nothing to do with the project again. So that's basically why, okay, so as you can see, most of the things are mentioned in apt-get install, but then again, if you do DNF install Python dev in Fedora, it will give you an error because Python dev doesn't exist in DNF. So it will be Python devil. So those are some of the things that you might need to search out in Google. Or if you want, you can make the documentation better and again send a pull request. So that both of the way works. So we would love to have your contribution if you want to provide some of the documentation and improve the documentation for other flavors or other systems that might help others to set up it up. But yeah, that's basically how you get the entire organizer server set up, and after you have set up, you get all the features ready to serve you. So that's basically how you set it up. Any questions? Basically that's it. If you guys have any question, you can ask me, or I will be around, you can talk with me later. Okay, this is my Twitter handle and GitHub and almost everywhere else. Thank you.